Hello and welcome to Binary Numbers Inside the Computer. What are we covering today? We're going to look at why and how computers use binary numbers. We are going to do a binary numbers primer with binary counting before we look at the main components of a CPU. We're going to explore data and control flow inside the computer, and then we are going to trace the function of a simple CPU. We're going to do this all in 15 minutes. So it all started with mechanical automata, and here you see a mechanical clock. These kind of machines, they started the computing revolution more than 2000 years ago. And we've had mechanical computers for quite some time. They're built from mechanical components such as levers and gears, and most commonly they add and count. We've had them from around 100 BC until about the 1970s and 80s. And examples include the Greek Antikythera, the stepper reckoner by Leibniz, Pascal's calculator, the difference engine by Babbage, or the Z1 by Zuse. They mostly use the base 10 number system, which led to a significant mechanical complexity. So you can imagine inertia, friction, and torque played a big role in the design and often prevented the proper function of these machines. You add material stress to it and engineering fidelity, and you get a very difficult problem to solve. And generally, yes, carryover is hard in those machines. The breakthroughs came in combination. On the one side, the binary number system was introduced in earnest, and there was a whole logic put around that. We call this Boolean logic. And then reliable cheap switches in the form of the relays came up, and they were very much used in the American telegraph. And once these were put together, we had the first computers, the first mechanical, electromechanical computers. This could have happened as early as in the 1850s, but back then nobody made the connection, so it took a little while longer, up until the beginning of the 20th century, before these machines were actually built. So today we're going to look into a CPU that uses binary numbers, and we're going to explore what binary numbers do and how they're being used inside the machine. And for this, I'm going to show you what's happening through the My Computer Brain platform. And if you're a teacher, you can go there, you can click on login, that will prompt a window, and you can create a free teacher account and follow along with the experiments. I'll do that later. And you can use also get student accounts and use that in class if you like. Okay, let's get started. Okay, here's my computer brain. I'm going to log in. It's my login credentials, wonderful. And then I'm scrolling down here to this picture, the girl with the binary numbers, clicking on it, and that will start the course. You click on the picture and that gets you started. Okay, so here we are in our first experiment, and we notice three different components. They're not all the components inside the CPU, but there are three with which we start. This one is a counter, this one is an adder, and this one here is a variable, which is a piece of memory that holds information that we give it. The first thing we need is power, so we connect these modules to power. Green light is on, they're all powered up. Now, they won't do very much yet, because the data is not flowing between these components. There's no data exchange, there's no data flow. So we connect data wires. In this case, these are 4-bit data wires because we are using 4-bit components. Imagine a CPU with 32-bit, they would be significantly wider. But 4-bit is sufficient to show the principle. So we have a variable and we set a value here, let's say 5, and the adder takes the 5 and adds it to a 0 that's coming here from the program counter. This one counts, okay? It counts up to 15. It's a 4-bit architecture, so it won't go any further than 15. But the adder faithfully adds two binary numbers. For the moment, remember that we have different components inside the CPU. There's always an adder, there's always a counter. Okay, let's go to the next one. Let's do a binary numbers primer with counting. Here we have our program counter again. And down here we have a little table where we can store our results. You could print a table in an Excel spreadsheet and give it to your students to fill it in by hand, or you could use it here on screen. So let's say we have a zero and we write down the binary representation of zero. Now you might say that's not ones and zeros, and you're correct, these are just dots. So let's switch this to binary numbers here. We go to the next step, write it down, and the next step and write it down. If you stop at this point and ask your students, so what do you think is going to be the pattern, the binary pattern of the next number? The students are most likely to follow the line here, like a geometric line, and say one, one. So they are going to say 0100, which of course, as we know, is not the right answer. And that's a bit puzzling for the students. Now, as we go along, they're likely going to pick up the pattern. What I found really helps is when we rotate this table, because we are trained to look at information horizontally. We read in our culture from left to right. And when we look at this data here, these columns horizontally, we see the pattern that 0, 1, 0, 1, 0. So it's alternating, then it's alternating by steps of 2, by steps of 4, and then likely here can surmise steps of 8. So there should be 8 zeros before the first one comes. And of course, yes, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So by looking at the information horizontally, students have another access path to finding patterns in the binary numbers. And then things are starting to make sense more quickly. Okay, let's look at the next part. So we've seen components, we've seen data flow. We know that components need power. And we have done a binary numbers primer through counting. So let's have a look at the next one. We could do this with 8-bit. We don't have the time here today. Let's look at two variables. Inside a program, we have variables. Here are two of them, let's say 5, 3, and then our adder adds those variables as we've already seen. The function of the program counter here in this experiment is really just providing power to the other modules. Here on the right-hand side, you see a little table which shows the binary addition as it happens inside the machine. So we notice that a CPU can always add. But what about subtraction? Subtraction is really hard for a machine, and we're applying a little mathematical trick here, which is the binary complement. So that is actually not so important. What is the important part in this little experiment is that we add another component in order to make subtraction happening. This one is an inverter, and its function is simply to flip the bits. That's all it does, okay? So a 0, 0, 0, 0, when activated, becomes a 1, 1, 1, 1. And notice how I'm activating and deactivating this. This one here is a line, this is a control line, okay, a 1-bit control line that activates and deactivates this component. So if I, for example, want to do, let's say, 5 and 4, so 5 plus 4, if this is deactivated, gives us a 9. But if I activate it, then it flips the bits and I get 1. The mathematical concept behind this is the binary complement, if you want to look it up. But 5 plus 5 minus 4 is 1. The thing to remember from this experiment is that we can switch components on and off in order to get the desired operation. Addition, subtraction. We can put this to good use later. So just remember this, that we can switch parts on and off. Here's another part that we can switch on and off. This one is a latch. This is like a short-term memory inside our CPUs, and its function is to remember the last result that we wanted to remember. So in this case, let's say we want to remember the value 5, we set our 5, and then we activate this component, and it will remember it. And change the value here and remember it. If we remember and then change the value, it will always hold on to the last value before we do an off-on cycle again. Now we'll have the new value. Okay, so we've got an intermediate result which we need in order to do addition. We will see that later. Again, remember, we've got a different part that we can also activate and deactivate. Now we do this manually, which is a bit impractical. You wouldn't want to do this manually inside of a CPU. You want that to happen automatically. So what we can do is do something very clever and use the clock cycle inside the CPU in order to activate this little component. So let's say we have got our value 5 that we want to remember. We now click the program counter, it sends a clock cycle, want to see it again, dup, dup, high and low, and on the high flag, our little latch will remember the value from the variable. You will later see how our latch will remember the value of an addition. Okay, so just in principle, so we've done away with us switching this thing on and off. The computer does this automatically now on every cycle. Okay, now we can take this concept a bit further and take a step towards memory. So if we take 16 of these latches and combine them, see this in the table here, then we can store 16 values. Why 16? Because it's a 4-bit machine here. So let's say we want our little display up here to display A, B, C, and D. Then we would start with the A, we would go to the next step, and then we'd say, well, put a 1 in there that represents the B. And we'd write this, notice how this line here becomes active, it turns red, and then we would go to the next step and put a 2 into it, and then the next step and perhaps a 3, that is our D, and perhaps the next step, we don't want an E, we might want an F, Okay, so if you now go back to our program and start it, say B, C, D, and F. Okay, so we can remember things in memory in order to use them later. In this case, as data that feeds into another module in order to trigger a lookup for a character. That's memory. Another component that we really need inside the machine is a data selector. This one takes one of two inputs and gives it to the output. So if I've got the 5 here and the 4 here, okay. So at the moment it uses the 5 from the left, but if I switch this one on again with control flow, then it takes the result on the right. Okay, so we can put these components together in order to build a simple general purpose machine that can add 2, 3 or more numbers. We're going to start by inputting first number, let's say that is 5, and then it's coming here from the left, and then it's going to be provided to the latch. So if I click enter, the latch will remember 5, and now I change this one because in the future I'm interested in the numbers coming from the adder. So we input the 4, 5 plus 4, and if I click enter, the latch will remember the 9. Click, here's our 9, so 5 plus 4 is 9. If I want to add another number, let's say 1, all I need to do is update here because the data flow is already on this side. This goes here in this loop, which is just interrupted by the latch. And I click enter and I get the 10. If I add another 2, I get my 12. So that's a very general purpose simple machine that can add 2, 3, or 4 numbers within the limitations of a 4-bit architecture. Okay, we can put everything we have learned so far together, and I apologize, it's a bit of a rush, but we only have 15 minutes, into a machine that runs programs repeatable to add and subtract numbers. Here is this machine. This is happening inside your CPU. It's just more complicated in that we have simplified that. But let's say we want to do the following calculation, 5 plus 4 minus 2. So first thing is we put our numbers that we want to manipulate into this data RAM here. We start with a 5, write it. Notice how the 5 popped up here. We go to the next step, we're currently in programming mode. We put the 4 in there, write it, and then the 2. So we've got 5 plus 4 minus 2. We haven't told our computer yet what we want to do with those numbers. So the first thing is we want to load a 5 so that it gets into the latch. This is the load command. Write that. Then we want to add, which is here, which is just 0. The machine always adds. We actually don't have to explicitly tell it to add. And in the last step, we want to do subtraction. Subtraction. This one is 1000, so it's binary numbers that we put into the program RAM. And finally, we want to write the result back into memory, which is a write command. Write. Okay, good, we are zeroing the program counter, we are going to runtime mode, and then we're going to run the program. And if we have done it right, we should get 5 plus 4 is 9, minus 2 is 7. Let's have a look. Okay. We will see the results here on the display. So first step is 5. We've loaded the 5. Now we're adding a 4, that is 9. We're subtracting a 2, which is 7. And we've stored this back into memory. Now I said it's repeatable, so let's do this again. 0, so I said load 5, plus 4 is 9, minus 2 is 7. If I run again, that's just an overflow. We ignore that result. The machine always produces things. We just have to decide what we want, what we don't want. We could do other programs. We've got some here, let's say 9 minus 3 minus 2. How is that going to be? 9 minus 3 is 6 minus 2. So we have put data and program code. The data is flowing through those colorful 4-bit wires. The program code is sitting in here, and you see these red lines activate and deactivate certain circuits. For example, we go back to 0. Here we are activating the selector for a load. Here we are activating the inverter for a subtraction again. And here we are writing into the data RAM. So what binary data does inside the computer is two things. So A, it provides the data that is being manipulated. And B, it provides the activation and deactivation signals that go to certain components inside the CPU and turns them on and off. And the combination of these two is a computer program. Thank you.